早晨各位同事，咁今
Members, good morning. We've just formed a quorum for the Establishment Subcommittee, so may I call the meeting to order? We've got only one thing on our agenda, and that is to deal with applications for late membership from 18 members. The letters from these members were circulated to members on the 8th and 10th of October via the LC papers numbers 5/14/15 and 6/14/15. I have asked the secretary to invite these members to attend this meeting and to give us written submissions for members' consideration. As at the 27th of November, 16 out of the 18 members have indicated that they're not going to attend any special meeting held for this matter, and two indicated that they were not able to make it to this meeting, and 70 members said they were not going to provide supplementary written submissions. Mr. Andrew Leung and Mr. Tony Zee wrote to me saying that they have already clearly stated the justifications for joining the subcommittee, and therefore they have no further points to add. And Mr. John Zee has also written to me saying that he is out of town and therefore cannot attend today's meeting. However, he did attend the relevant meeting dated the 11th of November. And the reasons for his joining this subcommittee are very similar to those for the PWSC. Mr. Tan Kim Po, in his reply slip to the secretariat, stated that he already attended the meeting on the 11th of November and he has no further points to it. And he demands that the subcommittee make a decision on the applications from these 80 members at once. Now, all these have been made available to members on the 27th of November through paper 15/14/15. May I remind members that according to our ESC procedures, para 3B, the chairman may agree to accept the membership on grounds of indisposition or absence from Hong Kong. A request for lay membership on grounds other than indisposition or absence from Hong Kong shall be put to the subcommittee, and the subcommittee shall accept such applications only when sufficient grounds have been provided. I'd like to deal with two things. First, after following suggestion, on a subject to members' views, I'm going to ask members whether we should consider all 18 applications in one go or one by one. First, I'd like to ask if members have anything to say on this matter. Mr. Gary Fan, 2 minutes each. How about this? Will members who intend to speak on this matter press the request to speak button first? All right. Well, today, all members who would like to speak, please press the button. Mr. Gary Fan, 2 minutes. I'd like to seek your view on a matter of procedure. You asked whether we should vote on this batch of late applications in one go or one by one. Yesterday at a PWSC meeting held to consider late application for membership, Mr. Albert Ho asked whether he could move a motion to adjourn, and he was reminded by the SG that motion to adjourn would only deal with funding applications from the administration, but not matters related to the panel. As far as I know, this is housekeeping matter. So may I consult our secretary? This so-called all-along motions to adjourn would only target at applications, funding applications from the administration. I'd like to know whether this is a convention. No, because this is a rare occasion, really, do we have a batch of members asking to join a subcommittee or a panel so late. So I'd like to know whether there is anything against the moving of adjournment motion in a procedure or rules of procedure. Is it just a convention that cannot be contravened easily? Secretary. Thank you, Chairman. The terms of reference of the ESC can be found in paragraphs 1 and 2 of the ESC procedure. As pointed out by Mr. Gary Fan, the terms of reference of ESC mainly to consider funding applications from the administration related to establishment matters. Of course, there have been motions moved under 32A. However, members are dealing with a late application to join the subcommittee. And members are dealing with this matter according to the relevant procedures. As the chairman, I mean as the secretary, I have read the relevant procedures. I'm of the view that a paragraph 32 doesn't apply to the current situation, but of course, the chairman's ruling is final. All right, I'll make a ruling here. Now, it's indeed a housekeeping matter. When we consider late applications from members, so such a motions should not be applied. Now, if you don't want this, if you didn't want this meeting, you could say no to that. But since the meeting is convened and is clearly stated in the relevant paper, the adjournment motions would only apply to proposals from the administration. So my ruling is that such a motion would not be applied to the current matter. So I've already addressed Mr. Gary Fan's point. All right, do we have another point of order from members? If not, we move on. So what are your views, members? Should we deal with all 18 applications in one go or one by one? After members have spoken, I will deal with applications from these 18 members according to majority view here. So do members have any views on this matter? Should we deal with the applications in a batch or one by one? Mr. Leung Yu-chung, please press the button to speak. This morning, I hope we all use the request to speak button because it's rather complicated if we have a show of hands and also a request to speak button. 3 minutes, Mr. Wu Chi-wai. Thank you. I don't need that much time. I noticed that members have used different justifications. Some said that they had no further supplementary information. So I think for them the case is closed because they had no intention to give us any written submission or to attend this meeting. As regards Mr. Pozzi, at the last PWSC meeting, he was present to let members understand his reasons for his late application. And he said that if members wanted supplementary information from him, he would be happy to do it by various means, including a follow-up himself when he is back in town. Since different applications, applicants have different responses, I think we should consider these applications one by one. Thank you. Mr. Lan Yuchong. Thank you. I concur with Mr. Wu Chi-wai. Because these members have different reasons for their late applications, and if we deal with them in one go, then we will not be able to discuss each case in depth. Because we said that with reasonable justifications, we can accept a late application. So we must consider each of the case on its own merits. Next, Ms. Tari Lee. So I have heard the remarks of the two previous members. They would like the applications to be dealt with one by one. He said that because these members furnished different reasons for the late applications, I believe we can deal with these applications in one go because the reasons already stated, and I think members here can exercise their own judgment to decide whether these applications should be accepted or not. Well, I think for me, I can accept whatever reasons provided by members requesting to join this subcommittee. Unless members have different voting inclinations, otherwise I believe that the main consideration should not be the grounds for joining this meeting. The reason, the main point is whether there is sufficient reasons for them to join this meeting. So I think we should deal with them in one batch. Thank you. So for the sake of members who are late, I'd like to tell you that we are dealing with this matter, whether we should consider all 18 applications in one go or one by one. Will members who would like to speak, press the request to speak button. Ms. Ito, 3 minutes. Thank you. There was a similar discussion at PWSC meeting yesterday, and I'd like to reiterate my position. Well, every year is routine for members to join panels or subcommittees. Now, this is already the third year into this term. Nobody can call himself a new member here. At the start of each legislative year, we have the same routine for conscientious members. They will check the papers or ask their assistants to check the relevant papers and indicate their wish.
At the same time, a lot of these members have also applied for other subcommittees. If members really care about their business, there's no reason they would make such errors. I would accept the grounds of some members. For example, Mr. Lo Wai Kwok. He said he made a mistake in filling out the form. So for me, that's acceptable. And for Mr. Leung Chi Cheng, he said he was busy with other business before, and as such, he couldn't reply on time. So I think it's okay. And Mr. Frankie Yik, he said there was traffic congestion, and Mr. Paul Che said he somehow said he was affected by social order. And he said, I think what he meant is it's important to restore social order. I think I'll leave this for the public to judge. So the members have different reasons. And for Dr. Ann Chang, Well, her reason is very special, and she said there are credibility issues among members, and as such, she wants to join this subcommittee late. And I think some of the members want to reject the proposals, and as such, they can bring the matter to the finance committee. And I see that different members have different reasons, so their cases should be discussed separately. Mr. Lee Chuck-yan.
Thank you, Chairman. I think these applications should be dealt with one by one because they have different reasons. But I'm rather disappointed that having read the letters, I see that no one has decided to come here. And none of the letters really elaborated on their grounds for late applications. And some members said they have explained their reasons in detail, but the fact is they have not. And I also cannot accept the fact that some members put the blame on their assistants. I stress that they didn't intend to file the late applications, but they only made the decision after realizing that the PAN Democrats have flooded into this subcommittee. So we have an issue with integrity, and if you put the blame on assistants, it's unfair because that's not the real reason. So we should give them a chance to rectify or elaborate on their reasons. According to the ESC procedure, we have to assess whether there are valid grounds. So if we are doing our job, the reasons given so far are not really adequate, save for a few of the letters, for instance, out of traffic reasons. But for letters from members such as Dr. Anne Chang, who said there are credibility problems, well, we should listen to their case and see if they have they can give valid reasons. But then a lot of these members decided not to come today. But Chairman, I think in effect this meeting is rather ineffective. But we do have to give them a chance to explain themselves. So I think that there's not much to discuss today. So I suggest we arrange another meeting to see if they would attend and explain themselves. I think that would be the best way to do it. Thank you, Mr. Lee. Next, Mr. Gary Fan.
Thank you, Chairman. The first day I joined LegCo, I told the media that I wouldn't commit any basic errors. I think this is one of them. Before we have to pay due diligence before we can effectively help the public. I think these late applications should be handled one by one. I think there are four categories or types of late applications. First is the type by members such as Dr. Anne Chang. She accused some of our members of being not integral. And for applications from members such as Paul Chair, he was relatively more honest, even though we might not agree with his reasons.
But he said he would respect the decision of the members. And the third type, some members have shouldered the blame for filing late applications. For example, Mr. Leung Chi Cheng, Mr. Wong Kok Heng, Ms. Alice Mack, Mr. Lo Wai Kok, Ms. Alice Mack. So this is the third type. So we should treat them separately. And the final type are members who put the blame on their assistants. For example, Mr. Jeffrey Lam, Andrew Leung, Mr. Tam Yu Chong, and Mr. Christopher Chong and Mr. Yip Kwok Him. So we are looking at four main types of late applications. They should be treated rather differently. So in terms of procedure, I don't think we can deal with all these late applications in one go. They should be dealt with one by one. And if members wish to have our discretion, we should at least be able to communicate and go back and forth. So this is the members' applications. So we shouldn't agree with applications from people like Dr. An Cheng, who filed applications because of their own mistakes. Next, Mr. Tan Ka Piu. I see that some members have already taken sides on the issue, and they are trying to delay the proceedings to July or even next year. So, Chairman, my question is, what is your do you have a timetable on when we should finish dealing with the applications? Even if we handle these applications in batch, we can still consider each case one by one. So the point is, we have to make a decision, or else I cannot really see when the problem can be solved. And as some members said, some applications are very unreasonable. I think everyone has already have their own judgments. If we invite these members for another round of discussion, then it wouldn't help. Let me cite an example. You are saying that members should be invited for discussions. If they decided not to come, the chairman may try to invite them again for the next meeting. But if they still don't come, then there's nothing we can do. Mr. Tan Ka Piu, I will address your questions afterwards. Mr. Kwok Kak Kee. Chairman, members have shared different papers. For example, Mr. Chen Kam Lam said his assistants made an error, and same for Mr. Tam Yu Chong. For Mr. Wong Kok Heng and Ms. Alice Mack, they didn't file applications because of personal reasons. For Mr. Jeffrey Lam, he also blamed his staff, and same for Mr. Andrew Leung. And for Mr. Paul Chair, he said social order was compromised, which affected the operation of the Legislative Council. For Mr. Frankie Yick, he said there was traffic congestion. These are all different reasons. We should be stringent at this subcommittee. And when we consider the applications, we would allow members to state their reasons. So that's the spirit of the LegCo. During the PWSC meeting yesterday, perhaps Chairman, you were also present. We value the applications from each and every member, and some members put the blame on their assistants. So in such cases, we would give them a chance to explain themselves. So it would be it's important for them to come here along with their assistants to give their reasons. And for some PAN constituency members, they are saying that there is some issue with their moral practices, but we cannot make personal judgments. And the best way of doing it is to invite them to actually come here. Chairman, you mentioned the possibility of processing these applications by batch. It's impossible because they are not rubber stamps. They gave different reasons: traffic congestion, social disorder, human errors, etc. So we cannot consider all these applications in one batch. So I recommend that we do our best to invite these members to come here or provide extra information. We really hope that they can be here. During PWSC meeting yesterday, Mr. Porcher was here. So thank you very much, Mr. Kwok. Next, Mr. Alan Leung. We are looking at something to do with paragraph 3B of the ESC procedure. And the key words are for applications filed after the deadline, the subcommittee must file late applications to members, and only when the grounds are valid, the subcommittee would accept such applications. And if some members said that they would accept these late applications regardless of the reason, this is unacceptable for me because we are not respecting paragraph 3B of the procedure. And if we accept all, then we are also disrespecting some members who have their own different reasons. So I think these applications should be dealt with one by one, separately. Chairman, I think we are not in an enviable position. Well, that's not what I think. Well, you don't have to agree with what I think, Chairman. During the PWSC meeting yesterday, I was the chairman, and I think my position is not really enviable. Well, perhaps Mr. Christopher Chung would envy you. Well, what I want to say is Mr. Lee Chuck Yan said these members should be given a chance to, and hopefully they would attend meetings of this subcommittee. Well, the fact is we have dealt with a similar scenario during the meeting, PWSC meeting yesterday. The only difference is, perhaps Chairman, you were also present yesterday. The PWSC actually invited members to attend three times, but they were all rejected. So today we are handling these late applications for the first time. I'm not sure how many times the chairman has filed invitations to the members, but I think if we invite them three times and yet they still decline, then let's just leave it at there.
I don't know whether my ruling yesterday has any impact on yours, but I think we have to deal with Mr. Lee Chuck Yan's suggestion. Does any other member wish to speak for the first time? Mr. Chen Chi-Chin, thank you. Chairman, I do agree that we should deal with these applications one by one. Although some members claimed that they had no further explanation or elaboration. It's as if we are begging them to come even though they have nothing more to say. It's all because we want to give them sufficient ample opportunity to explain or to elaborate. I think the tone in their letters is also different. Some made it explicit that they were not going to come, and some said that they weren't available this morning. Why are we begging people to come and elaborate a little bit more? This is because when members decide to veto an application, we want to feel that we have given them due consideration, because they may go to the finance committee to lodge an appeal. And if the FC is going to allow their late applications by majority view, well, that's the outcome. They can always resort to the FC, where their applications are bound to be accepted. We have to let the public know that if they are too busy and they're not available and they don't want to come here, that is not a sufficient reason. Perhaps we should change the procedure. Any application to join us or committee at any time should be accepted without any discussion or with no ground at all. So, Chairman, I suggest that we give time to those who could not make it this morning. Perhaps this meeting is scheduled too early in the morning. We should give them another chance. Now, if they have explicitly said that they are not going to come regardless or whatever, then we should not beg them anymore. And if we veto their applications, and by the time they appeal to the FC, we can then have something to stand by. Mr. Yip Kin Yun, thank you, Chairman. As you know, I am a teacher. Whenever I am faced with an issue, I would use my experience as a teacher to tackle the problem. For instance, a student was late and he said that, for instance, someone in his family, like his mother, didn't wake him up, so he was late. These reasons are quite common nowadays. And as a teacher, you may accept it from one student. It's acceptable. But come one day, a dozen or so students were absent, claiming that their mothers failed to wake them up and they had sufficient grounds to enter the classroom. As a sensible teacher, you will doubt. How come so many mothers had omitted to do this on the same day? Now, if once or twice a colleague claimed that it was an oversight on the part of his assistant, we would believe that it was a justifiable reason. But we have so many members here putting the blame on their assistants with identical letters. Even the greetings to the chairman was the same. So I think it is our duty to take this matter very seriously. When a teacher is faced with the same reason from students who were late on the same day, and if he accepted that reason, then he was not really a very fair teacher. So by the same token, we should very seriously consider whether the reasons given was really sufficient ground, and this is also the requirement from our procedure. The procedure said that only two reasons can be accepted: indisposition or absence from Hong Kong. And the chairman should always accept late membership on these two grounds. Other than that, there must be sufficient grounds before the subcommittee can accept such applications. So I believe these applications should be dealt with one by one. And we should ask whether these members have further points to make. Mr. Lang Kwok Hong, good morning, Chairman. Should we deal with these applications one by one? Of course. Well, when I'm arrested by the police, I'm always dealt with on an individual basis. He would say that, well, you entered the territory subject to an injunction order. And I think these letters were prepared beforehand, and the reasons given were rather rotten. Why indisposition? Are any of you indisposed? Yes, perhaps you're all a little bit sick. Yesterday I said that we would allow you to present a meeting in attendance, or if you can be punctual on two occasions, you can be properly accepted. Well, when we were filibustering, you have 40-odd members, and they were not able to prevent a meeting from being aborted, and you blamed us for that. Right, Ms. Sarah Lee, is it possible if these members can be punctual and remain to the very end at two meetings and to also comment on the agenda, then they will be allowed? Now, I tried once. I was not indisposed. I was in Hong Kong, but I was in jail. And I asked Mr. Albert Chen to join the Finance Committee on my behalf. And Mr. Lang Kwok Hong was not ill. He was not out of town. He was in Lai Chi Kok, but that application was rejected. Honestly speaking, I'm not going to allow these late applications because you really have to reap what you have sowed. I asked Mr. Joshua, I invited Mr. Joshua Wong to this building, and I was warned. I was almost kicked out of the council, but every Friday you enjoyed champagne and wine. You were feasting. How about that? So this council is rotten. Or perhaps they could give us a sick certificate, a medical certificate, but I hope they would not be sick with the same disease. All right, does any other member wish to speak on this matter? No? Then I have to make my ruling. Having heard members' comments, Oh, my apologies. Mr. Martin Leo? Thank you, Chairman, for giving me the opportunity to speak because I was dealing with other matters. First, we have to understand that every legislator is entitled to join a subcommittee if he or if they failed to join for different reasons. They have furnished the we don't have any principle binding on the reasons, and I think the overriding principle is some members do have the right to join subcommittees. And you want us to consider these applications one by one. They have already furnished their grounds for joining the subcommittee. And these members have already told us that they had nothing more to add and that they were not going to join a meeting held to discuss these late applications. So it's pointless even if you continue to invite them. As Ms. Ellen Leung has very rightly put, under paragraph 3B, we have to consider whether those grounds are sufficient or not. If they are not, we are not going to support these applications, and the opposite is also true. It's as simple as that. I always respect Mr. Long Kuo Heng's frankness. Now, he is honest enough to tell us that he has come decided, no matter what grounds you give, he is going to veto these applications. So the grounds are already provided. They have nothing more to add. They are not going to join this or take part in this discussion. The only thing we have to do here is to make a decision. There is no need for us to convene another meeting to consider the matter because they are not going to give us further grounds. And they're not going to attend a meeting. Now, if we want a debate, it should be a joint debate. And of course, when it comes to making a decision, it has to be made case by case. All right, does any other member wish to speak? So, having heard members' remarks, I'm of the view that these 18 applications should be considered one by one. And I have read the content of the letters very carefully. The only member, the only application I can deal with here is the one from Mr. Chan Kim Po, because he said that he was not going to attend any meeting of this subcommittee to discuss this matter. And of course, we cannot coerce any member to attend any particular meeting. Members are free to act as they like. And Mr. Chan Kim Po has made very clear in his letter that he had nothing more to add. So, at this stage, I can only deal with Mr. Chan Kim Po's application. Regarding applications from other members, they said in their respective submission that they were not available this morning or they had no further points to add.
But we must have evidence to show that applicant members have nothing to add before we can make a decision. So my recommendation is that we will look at Mr. Chan Kim Po's application today. For other applications, members have to make clear to the Secretariat whether they would attend any special meetings with regards to this subcommittee. I stress I'm talking about any special meetings regarding their late applications, and that they have no supplementary information. And I have to follow paragraph 3B of the ESC procedure in order for members to make a decision. So today I will look at Mr. Chan Kim Po's application. For all other applications, the Secretariat would issue letters requesting members to make it clear that they will not attend any special meetings regarding their late applications. Please let me finish. If applicant members state clearly that they will not attend any special meetings on their applications and they have no special
they have no supplementary information to add, then we will make a decision. You listen to Mr. Ray Chan's view, and yet you didn't. You ignored Mr. Martin Liao's comments. You are just wasting the time of the subcommittee. If you want to take this approach, you can ask the secretariat to issue a voting ballot for members to give their view. What you have misunderstood me. If members, applicant members, decide not to attend any special meetings, that's, we cannot do anything to force them. That's one of our principles. So we should exercise my rights under paragraph 3B of the procedure to see whether we accept Mr. Chen Kingpo's application. That's my decision, Mr. Wong Tingguang. Whatever your decision is, I think everyone can see what you are trying to do. We'll see whether you can do similar tricks in the future. I think karma will come around if you can put you can start a ballot if you don't want the members to come. You are accusing members who filed late applications, and you said that they are accusing their assistants, and you're accusing them for various reasons. So what is it that you want to say? For late applicants, I think we have to make a decision today whether you accept or reject their late applications. Next, Ms. Darley. Chairman, I don't agree with your decision. I'm very disappointed with your decision as well. At that time when you ran for the chairman of this subcommittee, you said you would be impartial and fair, and you said you would set an example for chairman of the establishment subcommittee, but your decision is clearly against what you've said. It's clear that some members want to postpone the ballots because of filibustering or other reasons. And they are against applicant members who just want to perform their duties. So this is just a trick. You are just playing tricks on us. We should just look at the information we have on hand and decide whether we accept the applications. And Chairman, you are very clear with it, but yet you allow members to delay the proceedings and filibuster. You are just you are allowing the filibustering to go on and wasting all our time. You want to deal with these cases one by one. Well, at the end of the day, you have the final say. But I hope that you will continue to discharge your duties as chairman and even if you ask the secretariat to issue letters, there won't be any extra reasons or information. And since you will be dealing with Mr. Chen Kingpo's application today, I hope you can allow a consolidated round discussion today so we can proceed to the ballot next time in order to ensure the operation of the subcommittee. I just want to explain my own decision. I request every applicant member to send me a letter to confirm that they will not attend any special meetings on their late applications and that they have no additional supplementary information to share.
So some members, for example, Mr. Porcher, he said he would attend if time allows. So we are looking at different situations and scenarios. If each applicant member issues a letter during the next meeting, I will invite a ballot based on their written submissions. I don't see anything wrong with it in terms of procedure. Of course, every member has the right to apply for this subcommittee. But at the same time, according to paragraph 3A of the procedure, the subcommittee can has the power to vet each application. Mr. Li Chaoyan, Chairman. For some members like Ms. Starry Lee and Mr. Wong Teng Kwong said you are playing tricks. Well, actually, you are the ones who are playing tricks. You are accusing people who have no right to speak. What we say here today can be heard by everyone. And if you accuse the assistants, can they say anything? No, they cannot say anything. So what kind of tricks are you playing? So what you're doing is very dishonest, and I just feel angry for these assistants because they are accused, they have no dignity. If you forgot to file applications, that's acceptable, as some members have admitted. So you are the ones who are playing tricks, and you just want us to reject the applications, and then you can take the matter to the Finance Committee to overrule our decision, and after that you can continue to stand up for the government, and you are trying to compromise our power to monitor the government. So that's the trick you are playing. And Mr. Chen Kim Po said he wouldn't attend any special meetings, and he even said that he had he actually said he had attended previous meetings, but at least he was present. For other applicant members, we are giving them another chance. So what's wrong with that? We are giving them another opportunity to elaborate on themselves. We just hope that they won't accuse their assistants. So, and we just hope that they can give more realistic reasons. So we should give these applicant members another chance to explain. Mr. Kwokaki, I think your arrangement is reasonable. But when vetting this list of late applications, we should come up with a date for the next meeting. You said members like Paul Chair wanted to attend a meeting but could not. And some other members might also want to attend. So we should fix a date for the next meeting as soon as possible and see how many members can attend. And some members threatened the chairman. I'm very angry because they might be used to not following the rules, but this is not the way we should do things here at the subcommittee. And some members have been very, for example, Mr. Chen Kim Po, he didn't intend to accuse assistants, but he gave a very reason. But I think that's acceptable. For members who lied, they should write a letter of apology. They shouldn't accuse their assistants. And if they're willing to write such letters, then some of us might change our minds. As Mr. Yip Kin Yun said, some liars might feel remorse of since they accuse their assistants. And in such cases, we should be lenient. But for members who continue to accuse the chairman, this is something unacceptable. We would accept your decision to carry out your duty in an impartial manner. Mr. Wong Teng Kwong,
shall we allow members who haven't asked questions in the first round to ask their questions? Mr. Kwokaki said some applicant members accuse their assistants. But this is just a speculation. He didn't have any valid grounds. So this is really, Chairman, I asked the relevant members to take back what they said. Mr. Kwok didn't specify which members. He mentioned a list of members who cited errors on their assistance parts as the reason for late applications. This is ungrounded. I want to give my say. I think what Mr. Kwokaki said is well grounded, because we have more than 10 members using the same reason. They all accuse their assistants, and very clearly it gives an impression that the Penn constitutional members are using their assistants as an excuse for late application. So I do not think that the chairman has to make his verdict, because Mr. Kwokaki is only saying the obvious. Any others, Ms. Darley? Well, Chairman, Mr. Gary Fan is accusing those applicant members. Chairman, I think you should give your verdict. Any other members who wish to speak? Mr. Kwokaki, Chairman, we don't want to accuse assistants or the applicant members, so that's why we want to invite all of them to come here. I was only stating the facts, and I want to give them the opportunity to explain themselves clearly. As a member, if so many applicant members are accusing their assistants, I feel really uncomfortable. Mr. Yip Kin Yun. Chairman, if so many applicant members are using the same reason, if their assistants frequently commit the same errors, let's say previously for other subcommittees, this reason might be valid. If they have committed the same error many times in the past, then this is understandable, but this is not the case. We are only looking at these two subcommittees. The probability, statistically speaking, this is very unlikely.
So I believe Dr. Kwokaki's speculation is reasonable, is not totally unjustified. I just want to point out this point. Ms. Sarili, now this is not really a mathematical problem, whether there is circumstantial evidence or whether there are any, whether it is a justified speculation. But Dr. Kwokaki accused members of accusing their assistants. So I ask you to listen to the tape recording, and I request that Dr. Kwokaki withdraw his groundless accusations. Now, Secretary, please advise me. Ms. Sari Lee said that Dr. Kwokaki made some remarks which were out of order, and that could apply to just one member or all 18 members. I'd like to know whether Ms. Sari Lee has any locus standi for using this reason to require Dr. Kwokaki to withdraw his remarks. So the first legal point is whether Ms. Tsai really has any locus standi to request or to demand that to be done. You may refer to ROP 45 or 41. Ms. Tsai really has demand that you make a ruling on Dr. Kwokanki's remarks. Under 41.4, it shall be out of order to use offensive and insulting language about members of the council. And five, a member shall not impute improper motives to another member. Perhaps you can invite Dr. Kwokanki to supplement his remarks, and then you can rule whether any member has breached our point of order. Secretary, my question is, does Ms. Sarili have locus standi to raise this point of order? Yes, when a member raised a point of order seeking a ruling by the chairman, it is really your judgment as to whether you're going to rule. Ms. Lee Jack Yan. All right, Ms. Sarili said that we framed members. Perhaps we should convene a hearing and invite members' assistants to tell us the truth. We want to find out the truth. We've asked them to come clean, but they refuse to do so. DAB members like to frame people, and if each time they do so, the chairman has to make a ruling, then the council cannot operate at all. Regarding offensive language, is it offensive to accuse a member of framing their assistants? I don't think so. When we criticize another member for his integrity, it is not something really offensive or insulting. It's not like Mr. Christopher Jones using foul language yesterday. So it's not offensive whatsoever. And regarding improper motive, well, the motive is to join this subcommittee, and some members framed their assistants because their motive is to join this subcommittee. And to want to join this subcommittee is not an improper motive. Ms. Wong Ting Kwong, may I seek clarification. Do we need a quorum to convene a meeting? Do we have any rules of procedure to require a certain members to be present before we can convene a meeting? Are you putting that request to me, Mr. Wong Ting Kwong? Yes, to you, Chairman. I'd like to ask whether a meeting can be convened so long as we have a quorum. And can we only convene or hold convene a certain meeting with the presence of a certain member? I've already answered your question, Mr. Wong Ting Kwong. We cannot require a certain member to attend a meeting because he is at liberty to do so or not. As for whether we can convene a meeting when we have a quorum, well, the answer is obvious. So I've already answered your question. Mr. Chen Chi-Chun. Chairman, no. Mr. Chen Chun, we are discussing this point of order from Ms. Sari Lee. No, I pressed this button to speak to support your ruling. Oh, all right then, Mr. Gary Fan, on the same point of order. Ms. Sari Lee and Mr. Stephen Ho are a bit anxious, and we are discussing whether we should allow these late applications. Of course, members are free to make their own judgment. My judgment is the same as Dr. Kwokanki's, and what I said, as confirmed by Mr. Wong Ting Kwong, is the pro-establishment members have put the blame on their assistants. 9 out of 18 members have put the blame on their assistants, 7 from DAB and 2 from BPA. And that's why Mr. Lee would like to point fingers at Dr. Kwakaki instead. They're supposed to, these 18 members in particular, 9 of them who have put the blame on their assistants should be here to elaborate and to give us grounds. We're trying to deal with these late applications very seriously, and I think it is really unreasonable. So why should we deal with this rule of procedure? Now what if I say that because Mr. Stephen, who is cornered, he has come up with this, there's a special point of order. The chairman was about to say that Mr. Chan Kim Po has given us a very clear written submission saying that he is not going to attend any meeting of the subcommittee. I think his ruling was very clear. Why do you want to point fingers at Dr. Kwakaki, Mr. Lee? Let me express my regret for Mr. Green Fan's remarks, which are far from the truth. We are talking about two different matters. You can query the grounds. What Mr. Yip Kyun said was acceptable to me. I did not ask for clarification, but Chairman, I request you to listen to the tape recording. Well, members were presumed guilty by Dr. Kwakaki even before a trial. So I think it is really insulting for him to have said so of members who've given us written he also imputes improper motives. And please, Honor, your platform. What platform? Oh, when you ran for the chairmanship of this subcommittee. Okay. Mr. Chen Chi-chun, still on the point of order. I was in line to support your decision to deal with Mr. Chen Kingpo's application, and suddenly Mr. Lee has this point of order. Now, if we are to be so calculating, Mr. Lee said that the chairman was procrastinating when the chairman decided to deal with Mr. Chen Kim Po's application first. Then I could also say that Mr. Lee was imputing improper motives to you. Actually, the chairman is not procrastinating. Objective result is for another meeting to be held to discuss applications from the other members. But Mr. Lee said on behalf of all these members that these members were not going to attend further meetings, nor were they going to give us further information. But actually, Mr. Lee, you have not read Ms. Pawsey's letter. He said that he was not in town today, and if necessary, he was willing to use email or any form of electronic communications, or to wait for him to come back to give us elaboration. Now, Chairman, I suggest that you adjourn the meeting and you listen to the tape recording, because the way it is now is not going to help this meeting. Mr. Lan Yuchong, just to share with you my experience, I have been accused of insulting other members in the past, and the chairman or the president would make his own decision as to whether the remarks were offensive or not. And if you haven't got sufficient information to make a decision, you should adjourn the meeting or suspend the meeting and listen to the tape recording and come up with a ruling. There is no need for a debate. So at this stage, either you make a ruling as to whether the remarks were offensive or not. And if you feel that you don't have enough information to make a decision, you can suspend the meeting to listen to tape recording. Whether it is offensive or not is a subjective feeling. Chairman, I asked for your ruling. I said Dr. Kwakaki put unconfirmed facts as if they were already confirmed. And I think the result is highly offensive. And this is the reason I asked for a ruling. Members raised their own suspicions. I have no views on that. And I'd like to respond to what Mr. Chen Jichun said. I asked you, Chairman, to give me justification for your decision. I asked for a joint debate, and I made it very clear that I expect that even come next time, you won't have extra information. So what Mr. Chen Jichun said was not true. Dr. Kwakaki, of course, my remarks were offensive. I'm willing to withdraw them, but my remarks are not offensive at all. For veteran members here who are also members of the Executive Council, I really appalled at her standard. How you view this word frame is a very subjective thing. Some may be very happy about it, and I have not imputed any improper motive. I really hope that I repeat it once again, that to shift the responsibility on your assistant is very ungentlemanlike. It is despicable. What I want is to give an opportunity for these members and their assistants to be present here to tell us clearly under what circumstances had the members put the blame on their assistants. If members have tried to evade their responsibility by blaming their assistants, this is very despicable and disgraceful. So I think we should give these members due notice and due opportunities so that they, together with the assistants who have been accused to have made a mistake, be present. I will certainly not withdraw such remarks that are not offensive in any way. Does any member wish to speak on this point of order? All right, I will make a ruling. Some members suggested that I should listen to the tape recording, but I don't think this is necessary. In relation to ROP 41.4 and 5, I'd like to express my ruling here. ROP 41.4, it shall be out of order to use offensive and insulting language about members of the council.
Insulting language about members of the council. 41.5,
a member shall not impute improper motives to another member.
而我解讀41.4和43.3個最。Now,
I think the three important adjectives here are offensive, insulting, and improper motives. These are three main factors. I think this is a subjective test rather than an objective test.
So in such case, Ms. Daly was speaking on behalf of all the members. I don't think there's a need to address the issue. And under Rule 41, bracket 4 and bracket 5, the words offensive and insulting language should apply to the relevant member being accused. Ms. Dari Lee said, "I'm trying to delay the matter. I don't feel offended or insulted, and I don't think it's an improper motive. This is a subjective condition."
the words offensive, insulting, and improper motives. Mrs. Stephen Ho, please wait. On this matter in this subcommittee, I do not think I have to give any ruling. Mr. Ho, you have 2 minutes. Chairman, why did you say that why did you think that this improper motive cannot be imposed on a third party member? So this is my ruling. This is there is nothing to debate. You can raise your objection, but this is the words offensive, insulting are subjective in nature. I think any reasons must be given by members insulted instead of others. I do not feel the need to address this issue, because if I'm to address the issue, I have to listen to the recording to see what Mr. Kwakaki said. I do not see any reason to do it. What I meant is, for members who are not present, we can accuse them in whichever way we want. If a member found that he or she was being accused from the tape recording, he can come here and he has to come here and make a complaint, right? After the chairman, according to the procedure, after the chairman makes a ruling, no further challenges can be made. So I think the debate can stop here. Let me make myself clear. In this subcommittee, this decision does not have any demonstrative effects on other similar meetings on the ruling of Rule 41, brackets 4 and 5. So, Ms. Starley, Chairman, I just want to go on record that even though I do not agree with your ruling, since the procedure didn't mention that other members cannot lodge such complaints, I respect your decision, and I don't want to give the impression that we are trying to delay proceedings at this subcommittee. So the matter is now resolved. The next item of the agenda is to deal with Mr. Chen Kim Po's late application. I will also tell you how I'm going to deal with the late applications from the 17 other members. I hope the Secretariat can come up with a date for the next meeting. If members cannot attend, they have to make it clear that whether or not they will attend any special meetings in the future with regards to their late application, and that they will not supply any additional information. We need the answers in black and white in writing. So application members must make it clear whether they will attend any meetings in the future, and that they won't have any additional information to share. So under such circumstances, the subcommittee will decide on these late applications. So this is my intended approach, Ms. Starley. I wanted you to clarify your ruling. You said your ruling is to handle these applications one by one, and I wanted you to make clarifications. Mr. Martin Liao requested dealing with these applications by batch. The Secretariat made it very clear. So would the Secretariat please ask the applicant members whether they will attend any
special meetings with regards to the late applications in the future. Ms. Darley, the issue of whether these debates should be carried out jointly or one by one is another issue. And we must have a decision whether we discuss, continue our debates jointly or one by one. And I will share my decision with you, share my grounds with you later. For Mr. Chen Kimpo's application, members, please look at the papers you have on hand. We have two sets of papers. If you don't have such papers, can the Secretariat, please? Chairman, I hope you can make the ruling now, because when we discuss Chen Kimpo's application, if we have a joint debate, we can talk about the other applications at the same time. But it's something about making the best use of the remaining 30 minutes in this meeting. Mr. Kokaki, since you have a ruling, so we shouldn't, we should move on, because we haven't really done what we have to do. We haven't set the date for the next meeting, and we haven't had the chance to ask questions of these applicant members, including Mr. Boche. He said he's willing to attend meetings if time allows in the future. We should be pragmatic. We should set up, we should come up with a few time slots for applicant members to make their choice. And I also agree with the chairman's decision to see whether applicant members are willing to attend any future meetings, and whether they will give their assistants a chance to explain themselves. I don't agree with Ms. Darley in further delaying the matter. We should deal with Mr. Chen Kimpo's application. Ms. Darley, followed by Mr. Gary Fan. Ms. Darley, please. I'm not trying to delay the proceedings. I have requested clarifications since the start of this meeting. I agree that we should request members to give their stance. I just want to make the best use of the time today. Mr. Gary Fan, I was here on time today, and I've dropped notes, and at least 6 or 7 members didn't mention a joint debate and separate voting. Mr. Stephen Ho and Mr. Wong Ting Kwong said, well, Chairman, you mentioned the possibility of a joint debate or separate debates. Mr. Ho and Mr. Wong prefer joint debates, but this is yet different from what Ms. Darley Lee said. And 6 or 7 members have given their views very clearly. They hope the chairman can consider the two options originally raised, that is, a joint debate or separate debates. Ms. Darley, perhaps Chairman, perhaps the Secretariat can clarify things. Well, I've made myself very clear, which Mr. Gary Fan might misunderstand me. Mr. Martin Liao also mentioned the same. Please, Chairman, please make your ruling as soon as possible. I don't want to waste any time either. And everyone agrees with dealing with Mr. Chen Kimpo's application today. I cannot deal with other applications any other way. So we should treat these applications one by one. If members feel that this meeting has been dragging on for so long, I'm referring to the applicant members, they have the right not to attend if they think it's just a waste of time. And if they have no more information to add, we will process such late applications as soon as possible. But for members such as Mr. Paul Chair, they only failed to attend this meeting because of personal reasons. For such cases, we have to, I will look at these cases in another manner. Today, I hope to process Mr. Chen Kingpo's application, and if time allows, we will deal with other applications. If some applicant members say they will never attend these meetings and they have nothing to add, we will deal with it separately. Since the reasons are all different, we cannot deal with such applications in batch necessarily. So let's save some time. I do not agree with your ruling. A joint debate is actually the norm, but you are doing something out of the ordinary. But as I said, I respect your decision, but you are just tolerating filibustering. Do you have Mr. Chen Kingpo's letters on hand? It's also displayed here on the projector screen. So these were what's written by Mr. Chen Kingpo, giving his reasons for joining this subcommittee. So you have 3 minutes to speak. If not, we'll proceed to the voting. After that, we'll adjourn the meeting. Since no members have questions to ask, we would put this matter to vote. Those who are in favor of Mr. Chen Kingpo joining, so we'll have an open ballot. The bell will ring for 5 minutes.
May I remind members that we voting on the question of whether Mr. Chen Kenpo's late membership should be accepted. Voting begins. Before I declare the results, can members please check their votes? Voting is closed. Display the results. Voting results. 9-4, 7 against. No abstention. I declare the proposal negatived. The meeting is adjourned, and we will fix another date for.